So lipid updates, implications for clinical care. So an important topic, practical topic, and I believe every one of us are, adept at treating most of them, but there are still certain doubts, certain misconceptions that still remain, that do remain, and I will try to, take them off. So moving on to the case. So let us look at a couple of cases. So this is our first case. She was a female of 57 years old, acute inferior wall MI, 3 hours onset. First episode of ACS, no history of hypertension, diabetes, and basically never had a lipid check like most of us do. So these are the ST elevations that you can clearly see, inferior wall MI. This was her angiogram. As you can see, this is the right coronary artery, totally occluded. And left main circumflex LAD had no significant lesions. So this patient underwent an angioplasty, primary PCI was done. The result was good, as you can clearly see here. What about the lipids? What about the lab result? So on day one, her labs were done. As you can see, most of them were pretty good. HbA1c of 5.8, so non-diabetic. Look at the lipid profile here. And if you look at the LDL and the total cholesterol, you can see the HDL is pretty good. The triglycerides are fine, but very high total cholesterol and LDL. Okay, so 247 by any standards, any figment of imagination, they are pretty high. So we do, what was the in-hospital follow-up for this patient? Patient did well, had initial runs of VT in the first 24 hours, but they were spontaneously terminated. The ejection fraction was good. The global ejection fraction was good. RV function was good. Patient was discharged on day 4. What were her discharge medications? Aspirin 75, ticagrelor 90 BD, atorvastatin 40 milligrams, ramipril 2.5, bisoprolol 1.25, amiodarone 200 milligram BD for the time being. So apparently the treatment looks fine to most of us. This was her outpatient follow-up. The patient went home pretty good. 1 month follow-up, this was the baseline in-hospital lipid profile that we just saw. 1 month, 50% reduction, that is what we do think so. The LDL came out to be 138. So you can see that the 50% reduction was not achieved with atorvastatin 40 milligram, though it was well tolerated. So what was done? The atorvastatin was increased to 80 milligrams. 3 months follow-up, the patient goes home, comes back after a couple of months, and the LDL is almost the same, has not come down. That means the goal of, say, 5 milligrams is not achieved. The dose increased to 80 milligram was already increased at this point, and still this was not achieved. So what was done? Ezetimibe was added, 10 milligrams over and above atorvastatin of 80 milligrams. So the question here is, if you have your voting pads ready, we'll vote here. Do you think the LDL, the cholesterol lowering regimen practiced here is appropriate? So I think the time starts now. How many of you feel yes? How many of you feel no? I think you can vote. People who have got the voting pads, I think they can vote. So let's see. Okay, so we are even Stevens. And most of you, it's a split verdict. Both the answers are, equivocal. So obviously it means that we are still, not very clear. But let us look at the guidelines as well and what do the guidelines say. So just a quick snapshot, and I'll present you the latest guidelines which have been put in. 2019 ESC dyslipidemia guideline. So without contraindication, high dose statins, class 1A. So 40 milligrams of, say, high statins. So if you see rosuvastatin 40 or 80 milligrams of atorvastatin should have been in the first place itself, high dose. Re-evaluated at 4 to 6 weeks, and the goal should be to get it below 50% of the baseline, right? So get it below 50% at least, and for a patient who has had an ACS, it has to be dropped below 70, ideally below 55. So it is 2A, level of recommendation C. And if it is not achieved after 4 to 6 weeks, then ezetimibe. So part of which we were correct, that that the regimen was still okay. But then it was still inadequate because the goal was not achieved. And that means we needed to do a bit more. So let us move on to the next case and then we'll move on to the guidelines. So this is a 60-year-old asymptomatic. This is the other spectrum wherein the patient is not yet symptomatic, an asymptomatic male patient. He presents for a routine follow-up concerned about the potential need for a statin therapy. Right, so this is the most commonly asked question to most of us. Hypertensive, non-diabetic, non-smoker, no family history of premature CAD, and apparently following a healthy lifestyle. Physical examination unremarkable, BMI of 30.5, so you can say overweight, to a degree obese. Blood pressure of 128/78. These are his lipids. Total cholesterol 206, LDL of 124 milligrams per deciliter, HDL 48, triglycerides 164, fasting blood glucose of about 114. So you can see an impaired fasting glucose level here, borderline elevated triglycerides, cholesterol and LDL. LDL, if you look at, apparently below 130, so fairly good. Now, after discussing the potential role of a statin given an estimated 10 years, so his ASCVD risk score was 10.6%. Okay, over the period of 10 years, the patient was still very concerned. So you do a risk profile for the patient. You tell the patient, this is your risk. The patient thinks that he's still bothered whether he'll have a CAD event in the future. He has not much, but at the same time, he's worried because most of the anecdotal reports, most of the research papers, quite a few of them have showed that statins have negative effects, particularly when he has an impaired fasting glucose, regarding cancers, potential for diabetes. So this patient is concerned. What would you do to allay his fears? Right? So what would be your next step in the management of this particular patient? Would you order a stress myocardial perfusion? Would you go for ischemia hunting? Would you do a coronary artery calcium scan? We'll have the voting pads, okay? Start statin despite patient objections as you think that he is high risk. 10.6 more than 10 is a high risk. Increase diet and exercise and have the patient return in 3 months. So these are your options. Let us vote. So most of you think diet and exercise should be a good option for him. Nobody thinks a stress myocardial perfusion, which is pretty good. So 30%, around 30% coronary artery calcium, and other people think statins. So this is, again, a divided house, but most of you feel that diet and exercise is a good option. Okay, so let us see how does CT scan, let us look at the guidelines. So let us look at what is the background and rationale, what are the treatment targets. We'll come back to the answer in a few slides from now. What are the pharmacological options and what are the changes that have happened in the new guidelines vis-a-vis the older ones? So if you look at the guidelines, the intensity of LDL therapy should be based on the risk. That is the most important point we keep on telling our colleagues. Look at the overall risk of the patient. Don't look at the LDL values per se in people who are asymptomatic, who have just walked into your OPD after a routine health checkup. Okay, look at the baseline, then you look at the baseline LDL cholesterol, and then whether lower is better, and if lower is better, then how much lower is better? Should you get down to 70? Should you get down to 55? Should you get down to 40? Right? So that is what we will look into in the few slides. So now the evidence, what is the source? CTT meta-analysis, ImproveIt, Fourier, ODC, all of them have shown that with mean reduction in cholesterol to great levels, you can actually reduce most of the outcomes, which includes CHD death, total mortality, and you can also reduce the coronary events in the future. So what are the treatment targets in relation to the risk? So very clearly, the risk profile has been established as far as patients who are low risk, moderate risk, high risk, and very high risk. So based upon the criteria, whether there is a documented ASCVD, whether there is diabetes with target organ damage, CKD, family history with familial hypercholesterolemia, these are patients, or risk score of more than 10%. These are very high risk patients. That means your target has to be 55 milligrams per deciliter or lower. So it is unambiguous. There is no doubt about it. Similarly, low risk, that means the target of about 116, less than 130, the risk score is very less. The patient falls into low risk, right? So the problem will come in the low risk and possibly moderate risk patients. For high risk and very high risk, the targets are very well defined. You know very well that statins have to be prescribed and the targets that you have to get down the LDL to. But these are the people where you need to evaluate and wherein you have to decide whether you need to prescribe statins or not. So the risk is something like this. So if you go on reducing from low to very high, if you reduce the level to about 55 and below, your CV risk also declines almost linearly. So that is very, very important. So there should be no doubt about the high and the very high risk group of patients wherein you should prescribe dose of statin at the right possible dose. And if the targets are not achieved, then add ezetimibe. And in the end, if the goal is still not reached, then consider adding PCSK inhibitor. So in the first group of patients with ezetimibe also, if the risk had not come down, LDL levels had not come down, you should consider adding PCSK9 inhibitor to that particular patient. So these are the recommendations. Ezetimibe and then PCSK9. So the guidelines have incorporated 2B and C, consensus opinion, and it may be considered PCSK9 inhibitor may be considered if cost permits. What about LDL lowering 2? Again, look at combination for PCSK9 for secondary prevention at very high risk 1A, very high risk familial hypercholesterolemia, statin, ezetimibe and PCSK9 is 1C. So familial hypercholesterolemia is a very high risk group of subset wherein you can consider PCSK9 inhibitor. And if you can't tolerate a statin, ezetimibe should be considered if you can't tolerate statin to any dosage. Statin-based regimen is not tolerated, PCSK9, 2BC, and again, if a statin combination with bile acid, if you still can't achieve the goal, then you can consider a bile acid sequestrant. So what about triglycerides? So if more than 200 but less than 500, statins would be the first drug of choice. But if more than 500, then consider omega-3 fatty acids, and that too, icosapent-ethyl, 2 grams, about 4 grams per day. So the class of recommendation is 2AB, should be considered after the REDUCE-IT trial that was just published. So summary of the guideline changes that we have already seen, target of 40 milligram. If a patient of ASCVD on statin but has second event, the target is less than 40 milligrams. For very high risk, 50. So the lowest is 39. So for every 20 to 25% reduction, for every 39 milligram deciliter decrease in LDL cholesterol, if you get them below 40, there is a 20 to 25% reduction in cardiovascular risk. So basically, these are small changes, but ultimately we have to take the leap. Many small people who in many small places do many small things can alter the face of the world. So I believe that these small changes that you do in your daily practice will actually help us in modifying the risk of our patients. To conclude, statins remain a mainstay in reducing cardiovascular risk. The addition of ezetimibe provides further LDL cholesterol lowering. New lipid guidelines endorse lower LDL cholesterol goals, particularly for patients with very high ASCVD. Only 1/4 of very high risk patients actually achieve. That means we need the additional LDL lowering with either ezetimibe and or PCSK inhibitor. So my friends, do not be afraid of prescribing high dose statins in patients who actually need it, and don't be, lethargic in considering additional options like ezetimibe or PCSK9 inhibitors in patients who actually need it and who are not reaching their LDL goals. And for asymptomatic patients, risk stratify the patient based upon the total ASCVD risk and then decide whether giving a statin would actually help him or not. And CT calcium scoring is an important tool wherein asymptomatic patients in dilemma whether to give statin or not will actually help you in starting a statin or not, because this will be a question of long-term therapy, and also looking at the risk profile of statins vis-a-vis not giving statins should be considered. Thank you.